Hey, brothers and sisters, this is Brother Patrick. Hey, I'd made a couple of videos last night and I didn't feel right about loading them. I kept feeling this grievance about loading them. So I did not load them. And then last night I had this dream from the Lord. And this is the point. The video I made was called The Church and the Blood Moons. And then I did a prayer for people. But there was a heaviness in my spirit when I tried to do the prayer for people. Some of the people I got a pretty good word, but it was just a heaviness in the spirit and a grievance. So I prayed about it, and you know, I didn't load them last night. I've decided that I'm going to redo the prayer overall, praying for people also. But brothers and sisters, you know, there's seasons. There's times and there's seasons, and to everything, there is a season under the sun. As it tells us in Ecclesiastes, you know, like the song that was sung by the birds, it's actually straight from Ecclesiastes. To everything, turn, turn. There's a season, you know, a time to be born and a time to die. A time to laugh and a time to cry. A time to make war and a time to make peace. And it goes on and on. There's a time for everything under the sun. And brothers and sisters, we are at a high time. And then for me, brothers and sisters, you know, for the last season, the Lord has used me to speak to the church. When I say Gentiles, I mean, you know, the church is mainly made up of Gentiles, even though there are Israelites who are also Messianic, you know, born-again Jewish people, Israelites, who what they say is they fulfilled their, you know, and completed their relationship with God through Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus the Messiah, for we say in English. In Hebrew, Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus the Messiah, Jesus the Christ. Anyway, brothers and sisters, imagine, if you will, that the kingdom of God is the mountain of God, as it talks about, you know, a stone cut out of the mountain, not cut with hands, as it says in Daniel. And then that stone is thrown, I believe it's Daniel chapter 2, the interpretation of King Nebuchadnezzar's dream. And that rock, there's a rock that's cut out of the mountain, not made with hands. Now that rock, of course, is Jesus Christ. And it destroys the statue of the kingdoms of man. And then that rock becomes a mountain and fills the whole earth. Now that's the kingdom of God, brothers and sisters. Now spiritually, the earth is filled already with the kingdom of Jesus Christ in the heart of his believers. Now, the day is coming when the Lord returns to earth, that the whole world, the millennial reign of Christ and all that stuff, and the Lord will return to earth and rule and reign, and he'll rule him with a rod of iron, and we, you know, the church, the bride, will rule and reign with him, and for that 1,000 years, all those things. But here's the point. On the mountain of God, brothers and sisters, you know, I've been to the mountaintop. Praise God. There's lots of people that have not been to the mountaintop. Let's imagine at the bottom of the mountain is salvation. At the top of the mountain is walking with garden in the garden with the Lord in the cool of the day. You know, I come to the garden of alone while the dew is still on the roses. You know, and the voice that I hear falling on my ears, the sound of God, you know, disposes. And when he speaks, the sound of his voice is so sweet that the birds hush their singing. And that's the song I keep hearing in my spirit now. I come to the garden alone. But on the top of the mountain, brothers and sisters, is the garden. You know, walking with God in the cool of the day. I challenge you to go up there. I challenge you. Some of you go up there and lots of you don't go up there, and you want somebody else to go up there and tell us what you see. You know, go to the top of the mountain and come back and tell us what you see. And I know that that's part of my calling from the Lord. I'm not complaining about it. I'm just complaining about your lack of faith, your lack of anointing, your lack of relationship with the Lord, your lack of prayer, your lack of reading the Bible to go to the top of the mountain. This is what I'm saying to you, born again, you know, former Gentiles. I'm picking up on some of the stuff I said in the other video, and it's true in the Bible. It tells us in the New Testament, Paul tells us there's the church, Israel, and the Gentiles. So when you become a member of the church, the Bible says it's one new man. You know, all are one in Christ. The middle wall of partition is broken down and we become one new man. That wall of partition was between the court of the Gentiles and then the, you know, the men and women's court of Israel, the court of Israel and the Gentiles, and the women's court and the men's court, you know, the Israelites' court, and then there's the court of the Gentiles. You know, that's where the money changers set up. You know, and Jesus said, you know, my house will be called a house of prayer of all nations. It's really, you know, one of the gospels says that this is a house of prayer for all nations. And that's the middle wall they're talking about, the wall that separated the Gentile, court of the Gentiles, you know, those who were converts, proselytes, from the court of the Israelites. That wall has been broken down. We become one new man in Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus the Messiah. In Christ, we're one new man. So when an Israelite gets saved, then they become part of the church. When a Gentile gets saved, they're part of the church. We're reconciled in Christ. God will reconcile all things in Christ. But this is what's going on right now. For there is a season for all things, brothers and sisters. So I made a video about the blood moons and the church. And then, like I said, I didn't feel good about it. Even though it was, preaching, because the Lord had given me a word, and I went with it. And the word the Lord gave me was from Zechariah chapter 1, is I will once again choose Jerusalem. I will once again choose Israel. God will once again choose Israel. So I talked about how that, you know, and I talked about the blood moons. And those blood moons, let me tell you, the blood moons is all about Israel. It's not about the church. The tribulation is about Israel. It's not about the church. So I was talking, you know, hey, we Christians, we're not involved. We should pray for the peace of Jerusalem. We should evangelize Israel. And then, hey, we're about to be raptured, and then the tribulation is going to begin. And that's true, brothers and sisters. That is true. Okay, but last night I had this dream because the Lord had been dealing with me for about 2 days about this blood moon stuff. I've been avoiding all that. You know why? Because I've been at the bottom of the hill entertaining and holding the hand of the people on the lowest end of the mountain. I've been talking to the Gentiles and telling them, you know, hey, get saved, you know, evangelizing and all this kind of stuff, reaching out off the bottom of the mountain out to those who are not on the mountain, those who are out in the world, and dealing with those who are on the bottom of the mountain. That's what I'm trying to tell you. I'm going to get to Israel in a minute. When you are dealing with these denominations, let's just call it out because it's where I came from. You're talking about your Baptists and stuff, okay? You know, Catholicism, they got all this, their own wacky doctrines that's so far out there. You know, it's nothing to do with the Bible. In other words, as an example, there are no priests in the New Testament. There's one mediator between God and man. That's the man, Jesus Christ, the Bible tells us. Jesus Christ is a mediator. Now, what the Catholic Church tries to do is give themselves this authority of saying they're the way, the truth, and the life. So they have a priesthood, which they're not authorized to have a priesthood. Just like the Mormons, they have a Melchizedek priesthood, an Aaronic priesthood. In other words, they have some kind of a authority and a mediation to God, like Jesus never came and died on the cross. That's what the Catholic Church is doing. They're saying that we are the way, the truth, and life. You receive graces through the sacraments of the church. And if we won't give you the sacraments, you can't be in a state of grace. And if you're not in a state of grace, you can't go to heaven. So they are the way, the truth, and life. You must go. No one comes to God but through the church. That's what they're saying. That's what lots of these denominations do. As a matter of fact, you know, these cults, particularly Jehovah's Witnesses, Mormons, all this kind of stuff, they all have the same basic concept, that they've given themselves and exalted themselves in the place of Christ. And that's why that's the problem. But let's talk about born-again Christianity. Let's talk about, say, from Baptist to the right. When I say right, I mean more conservative, more orthodox, to your Assemblies of God, Church of God, all this kind of stuff, your Spirit-filled Christians, starting with you know, those who take the Bible literally, Gentile people. Okay, so there are people, and I say this all the time about the shallow end of the pool. I've mentioned that, you know, I went on a kick where I kept saying that. I'm not talking about new believers. I'm talking about, you know, God has mercy on the new believer. It's those who have been Christians for 30 years and they're still on the bottom of the mountain. And they've camped out on the bottom of the mountain and they keep, I know I'm saved, I'm saved, I'm saved, I'm saved. Praise God, I remember the day I got saved. It was right over there in the corner of the church. It was right there on the right side, and I remember the sister and so-and-so saying, and they just keep reliving, you know, being born again, without saying that, hey, when you're born, you need to learn to walk, talk, eat, go to the bathroom, feed yourself, you know, grow up, become a teenager, go to school, learn something, become an adult, a productive member of the kingdom as a mature, full-grown man or woman in Christ, as it tells us in Ephesians chapter 4, starting in verse 11, that God gave us some apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, some pastors, some teachers for the perfecting of the saints, till we become one new man and one man perfected in Christ. So I've been working on the on the bottom of the mountain for a pretty good while now, for the last few years. I've done some other stuff when I taught about the pyramids and all that. The Lord is calling me back up the mountain. He's pulled me back in, which I never watched The Sopranos, but I heard about it. You know, and that's a famous quote. You know, the Lord pulled me back in to go up higher on the mountain, brothers and sisters. So I must go where the Lord calls me. So I asked you, those of you who have an ear, let him hear, come up higher on the mountain. You know, there's shortcuts to the top of the mountain. There's secret, there's secret passages to the top of the mountain. I don't say secret. There, you know, you have to have eyes to see and ears to hear. Through praise and worship, through meditating on the word, you can take the elevator to the top of the mountain. You don't have to climb the mountain every step. Some of us have different steps to take. Some of us getting to the top of the mountain is much harder than others. But as you grow and develop in the Lord and have your flesh subdued, of course you can get to the top of the mountain higher. So I'm going with this analogy without getting into what I want to talk to, as the Lord has arrested me to talk to Israel. And I'm wearing this red shirt, brothers and sisters, specifically red. And those red blood moons, is the word is danger, 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 as in danger, real Will Robinson, danger, danger, danger. Danger is coming. Danger for Israel. And what I said in the video last night was, hey, we are the church. We're out of here. And then what the Lord is telling me, hey, you know, the danger for the church is to fall into this trying to keep the law. That's what I've been saying. That's why I've been holding the line with the Hebrew roots movement. Because when you get into the sacred name and you then you have to pronounce it a certain way and all this, you know, and the next thing you know, people are wearing yarmulkes and trying to keep the law. And that is a pit. That is a pit. That is a slippery spot on the side of the mountain. And many slip off the mountain when they hit that spot, when they try to climb up onto going into the higher things of God, when you're talking about Israel and all that. They slip off the ledge of walking in the one new man. Go back down into the valley, off of the mountain. And I've been warning and warning and warning people. But, brothers and sisters, the root of our religion, the tree, as it tells us in Romans chapter 9 and chapter 11, when you read that, you'll see that the root is Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. The root of our faith is to Father Abraham. The Bible tells us that we are children of Abraham, adopted through the blood of Christ. So we have a certain heritage and obligation to pray for the peace of Jerusalem. Now, of course, the peace of Jerusalem will not come until the Lord Jesus Christ comes back. That's it. So as I said in the video last, I don't think I said it now, the blood moons, danger is coming to Israel. I believe it's going to be the war of Gog and Magog. And then I believe that out of the war of Gog and Magog will come the 7-year peace treaty. And during that process, from the war of Gog and Magog, excuse me, I'm sorry. The King James is the correct translation. As I say, if you want to go watch A Lamp in the Dark, you'll discover that all these modern translations are actually funded for and planted by the Jesuits, believe it or not. Go watch and see. They backed the people who mysteriously found these new translations that are correcting errors from the Receptus, Scriptoris, whatever. All those Latin words have too many repetitive sounds for me. But the Receptus Scriptoris, whatever, the Bible that was passed down for hundreds of years, or even thousands of years, was suddenly there's some new copies found that they changed the Word of God, okay? And they're trying to override those texts that were accepted and passed down for all these years with some allegedly older text they found, which is not. Anyway, brothers and sisters, that's part of the deception of the end times. I believe the war of Gog and Magog will be at the center of these blood moons. That's the purpose of these blood moons. That's why the Lord even told me to wear this red. And I guess I should have made a video warning to Israel. I always get stuck trying to talk to the Gentile church, the former Gentiles who are now part of the body of Christ, the church. It'll be the war of Gog and Magog, brothers and sisters. And then even as that happens, the Bible tells us that, as I said in the King James, that five sixths of these people are going to be wiped out. Persia, Russia, all these Muslims and stuff. That's why I'm telling you, Islam will not be issue. We will not attack Iran. If we do, that would delay the end times for a pretty good while, because Iran needs to be powerful. Russia needs to be powerful to make this sneak attack on Israel. And I believe that when they attack Israel, it doesn't say in the Bible, but they may try to take the United States out first. There may be some kind of EMP bomb on the United States or whatever, something that would neutralize us. But it says in Ezekiel 38 and 39, it says that the sons of Tarshish and all their young lions, that's the English-speaking people of the world, they just say to the Russians and the Persians, oh, have you gone to make a spoil of Israel? So, you know, it's weak leadership in the West, which we have right now. There is no leadership in the West. The Antichrist is not here, because the Antichrist is a man of fierce countenance. And he is, no one can make war with him. He's a tough guy and a smart guy and a charismatic guy. And the whole world will follow after him in a day. There's nobody in the West like that. Anyway, brothers and sisters, the Lord is, you know, I don't want to get sidetracked with all this stuff. I'm tired of dealing with all these people who are, if they're even on the mountain, they're at the bottom of the mountain, and they're reading stuff and just perpetuating, repeating what someone else said, and not getting it from the top of the mountain. Anyway, brothers and sisters, these blood moons is about Israel. And I guess I need to make another video warning to the people of Israel. And this war is coming for them. And we as Christians should be praying for them. Pray for the peace of Jerusalem. We should stand with them. And the Bible verse is fulfilled, you know, that the day is coming when a woman will surround a man. I don't know if I mentioned that the Lord has had spoken that into my spirit 100 times, and then finally, the Lord gave me the interpretation. I can't remember if I mentioned this in the video or not, because I've been concentrating on evangelizing and that kind of a thing. But that is the church standing with Israel. The church standing with Israel. And I want to give you another word. The church is the woman. And, of course, Israel being the man. The Lord said, you know, it's a dual meaning to lots of Bible verses. When it says, out of Egypt I called my son. That is also true, for Jesus was called out of Israel as his son. But Jesus was called out of Egypt as his son, but so was Israel. God says, Israel's my firstborn. My firstborn is Israel. And he called them out of Egypt also. So things have multiple meanings. So I got to make this another video, I guess, because the Lord is just coming upon me to prophesy, and the Lord's been showing me a vision. And I had a dream last night about Netanyahu and all this kind of stuff. And the deception of the aliens is coming. I was pleading with Netanyahu to receive Jesus as the Messiah. I was pleading with him. And he was not accepting Jesus, but he was calm, cool, and collected and at peace. But we went outside, brothers and sisters, and all these aliens came. I rebuked them in the name of Jesus, and they left me alone. But everybody else was caught up with this, like a mind control thing from the aliens. The great deception is coming. But I look and beheld, there was an old man walking with a cane. And that old man is Israel. And then I look, and lo, I beheld an ear of corn. And the shuck was removed, and I saw that the corn was ripe and ready to eat. And the Lord has told us in his word, as Jesus spoke from his own mouth, the harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Therefore, pray that the Lord of the harvest will send forth laborers into the field to harvest this harvest. For the harvest is at hand. For the Lord of Sabaoth is on his way. The Lord is coming. The Lord is coming. That's why I'm wearing this red shirt. Those who are not in Christ, those who are not on the mountain of the Lord is a sweet-smelling savor to those who love him, who are found in Christ. But he is the smell of judgment and death in the nostrils of those who are his enemies. For the Lord is good. and his love endures forever. That's a song, but it comes from the Psalms. You know, for the Lord is good, and his love endures forevermore. I know I can't sing, but the Lord keeps leading me to. For the Lord is good, and his love endures forevermore. Hallelujah. Brothers and sisters, I ask you to pray and pray for Israel. Pray for the peace of Israel. Brothers and sisters, I know that we're in the midst. I mentioned in the video, but I was loading that video this morning. I was debating whether to load it. I tried to load it. I talked about the orphanage and all that. We already bought the vehicle. I ask you to pray for me as the Lord would give me this calling to go to a higher level of teaching to a different audience, brothers and sisters, to the nation of Israel. That they would hear the truth in love, that we can give them the pure word of God, not anything else but the pure word. Now that's the problem with all these religious people. That's why God had to send John the Baptist and people like that, who are outsiders, non-denominational, not controlled by religion, but pure water of the Word that's not been turned into coffee or soda or what. It hasn't been tainted by religion. Israel will accept nothing less than the pure Word, living water of the Most High God. That's why God always chooses outsiders. Jesus himself was born in a manger. John the Baptist was in the wilderness. All of these things, the servants of God, the real servants of God, as Jesus said, they crucified the prophets. Or they killed the prophets. Even in between the porch and the altar, they killed. Was it Zechariah, son of Berechiah, was killed in the temple by those religious people. So even today, when you go to churches and you deal with these denominations, they want to know, well, you know, who are you under? Who's controlling you? So they want to know who's controlling you. It is true. I will tell you this. There are lots of people out there who are running around on their own talking wacky stuff. But the real servants of God have to be out there. You cannot really get out there and speak freely as the Spirit of the Lord moves you when you are under the control of a denomination, because they have their boundaries. They have their limits. They have their man-made control. And that is the reason why, even if you have 99 rocks, it is worth going through 99 rocks to find one diamond in the rough, as they say. It is worth it. Than to have a bunch of, you know, the Lord has just given me that. Hey, that's pretty good. You know the cubic zirconia? A denominational preacher is a cubic zirconia. I mean, it's like a diamond, but it was man-made. I can make a video just on that, brothers and sisters. I think I'll make it. I need to start making these short clips and start shouting, what? And are you serious? You know, just for, you know, I could tap dance and get some, you know, some entertainment value in there. A denominational preacher is like a cubic zirconia. It's pretty cool. You can get by with it. It's kind of all right, but it's not the true and genuine natural made or, you know, God made diamond. But you have to go into the rough to find the diamond. I got to make a special video on that, brothers and sisters, because that's pretty cool. And I thank the Lord for his wisdom. And the Lord has given me that because I'm being obedient. I didn't load those videos that I had made. I was halfway through loading that first video, even though didn't load it last night. I tried to load it this morning. God bless you guys. We got the vehicle. I'm going to be going there tomorrow by the grace of God, and I'll make some videos and stuff all about what's going on at the orphanage. And God bless you guys. But the orphanage and all that's just part. I mean, my calling is to preach and all that stuff. And orphanage is part of that, brothers and sisters. I'm not the house dad. We have, you know, the Lord has given people a calling to do that. And, by the grace of God, we can do all these things through Christ and what we're doing. As God leads us, all these different kind of things for the Lord. And I thank all those who have donated help us to do it. I'll be talking about that tomorrow. Let me make another short video. I'm going to load these videos. And I'm going to redo the praying for people. One person, I told them that I'd given a word for them. I'm going to redo it. And basically with that person, I had like three or four different words. But the main word was is that your concern and your worry was about your husband. You know, God's in charge, got to make a way. Sister H. B. God bless.